Hello and welcome back to this week's episode on Amplify. My name is Sanchi Singh, and for the final episode of Season 2, I wanted to get into Indigenous rights and justice. As some of you may know, on 9th August, it was the International Day of the World's Indigenous People. These are the people whose way of life has always been sustainable and has hugely inspired and encouraged our own movements, choices, behavior, consumption patterns, and so much more. And that's great. We should look to them, who have been the custodians of nature for so long, to show us the way. But is following in their footsteps and striving for zero waste living or circular economy models enough? Is eating plant-based, buying secondhand, upcycling, recycling, etc. sufficient in and of itself to move towards a more environmentally just future? I doubt that. Because if we talk about growing and eating local, but not about stolen forests and lands and displaced indigenous communities, or if we talk about switching to electric cars and bikes, but not about how specific communities have become dumping grounds for waste, then our sustainability is performative. To live and act sustainably is to unlearn and criticize current systems that exist, and actively, constructively agitate for better, more equitable systems instead. It's a verb, it's a practice, it's imperfect, it's unglamorous, and it's a long, long journey. For this episode, I am speaking to Adivasi Lives Matter Movement in India to talk about some of the key issues, such as EIA Draft 2020, larger issues such as land rights, displacement, environmental racism that affect Adivasi lives directly, and understand what we can do to amplify their voices.
Welcome to this week's episode on Amplify. Today I'm speaking with Ashish Biruli, who belongs to the Ho Indigenous community of Jharkhand, is an independent photojournalist and activist, as well as a founding member of Adivasi Lives Matter movement. And Isha, who is a content strategist, a documentary filmmaker, editor, and co-creator of Adivasi Lives Matter movement, hereafter known as ALM movement. And I'm so glad to have them here for this episode to talk about ALM and sustainability and, of course, Indigenous rights. So thank you so much for being here on this episode, guys. I really appreciate it.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sachi.
So just to start off, can you just talk about, Ashish, you are the founding member of Adivasi Lives Matter movement. So can you just talk about the need for this and what encouraged you to start this movement?
So I'm not the only one who is involved in this. It all started with Ankush Vengurlekar. It started in 2016 when he first came to Jharkhand. He was on a cycle trip to the indigenous belt in the states of Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, and Odisha. And that is how we met. So before that, I would like to give you a brief of Adivasis in India. Stories have always been told by non-Adivasis, and also where I live, I also call myself as a photojournalist and I do photo stories. So in my personal life, I started my work because I felt a need that Adivasi should begin telling his stories of his community and not being dependent on mainstream media or any photojournalist or any documentary filmmakers. So Adivasis are also capable in this modern age because they are also adopted to technologies. They are comfortable using those things. And when Ankush came in that year, so he personally observed the richness of Adivasi culture. And there the conversation of both of us started that he also came to know that I was the only first international photojournalist of Jharkhand. My photos had been exhibited on international platforms. And that inspired Ankush a lot. He thought, if Ashish, being an Adivasi, can tell his stories, why not other Adivasi people, other youth of Adivasi community? So that is how Adivasi initiative started. And also when we read stories about Adivasis, we always read and also come to know only the sensitive issues of Adivasis. But in Adivasi Lives Matter, our main motive was not to only to highlight the sensitive issues, but also the motive was to show the richness of Adivasi culture. It could be the food, the richness of food, it could be the songs and festivals. So that was lacking in many mainstream or any online platforms. So I was very much interested because where I live in a very sensitive zone. My hometown is the home to India's first uranium mining, and it is known as India's best kept secret place. And I have been documenting these serious issues since long back in 2013. So I felt this is a very good opportunity when I will get a platform where I can tell stories of the good stories of Adivasi Lives Matter. So when we talk about Adivasis, unless we know about their rich culture, we cannot imagine or we cannot understand what impact it will be on Adivasis.
And so can you talk a little bit more about how you feel or the ways in which perhaps more specifically, the ways in which Adivasi people have been misrepresented in mainstream media or conversations?
So the first thing when anybody non-Adivasis hear about Adivasis, they always imagine a person wearing leaf clothes made of leaves or like the Jingalala ho. That is the first image they imagine when they hear the word Adivasi. And apart from this, in movies also, Adivasis have been portrayed as a villain, as a very negative people. And also they have been portrayed as uneducated, and sometimes they are portrayed as cannibals also. So that is the very negative image that has been portrayed since a very long, long time and period. So that needs to be broken. And that's what Adivasi Lives Matter is doing right now.
Yeah. And you know, when we talk about intersectionality, which is such a popular concept now, it's all about, you know, understanding the various intersections of class and religion and gender and caste and communities that people exist in. And it's such a popular concept to talk about, but then one can question whether it is actually being used in practice. So when we look at the conversation in India itself, you know, there's all of these people who are non-Adivasi, who are upper caste and who have a lot of privilege. They often feel very guilty for having this privilege. But do you think guilt is perhaps a wasted emotion? Like, how can we in practice be more proactive in making conscious efforts to amplify Adivasi activists, the Adivasi Lives Matter movement, creators, teachers, etc.?
I think it all should begin from appreciation and acknowledgement. All the communities, what I have observed is even Adivasis and non-Adivasis, each and every community thinks of that particular community as very supreme or very superior. And that should not continue. All the communities should first understand, acknowledge that we all are from emerged or have come to this particular period from one ancestor. Our ancestors were one at the very beginning point. And at this point, we should always understand that we all are humans. And also, I would like to add this, that all these issues have emerged, like I said, superior and of ruling. And also, we all humans are genetically coded to save our own species. So I think that is also a topic we should also accept.
Just to add to that, so I'm a Hindu, I'm a Brahmin, so I have a lot of privilege to deal with, especially when I work with Adivasi and tribal communities. And it is, like you said, guilt is a big part of that, because once you start, until the time that you are ignorant of the privilege that you have, it's a very easy situation because you don't have to think about it. It's not anywhere on your radar. But once you come across this concept, it's very difficult to sort of unsee it. And then you can't stop thinking about it because it is infiltrated in every single aspect of your life. And being in this extremely privileged position, it hit me really hard in the beginning, because I was like, once you start learning about what people have done, how the caste system works and how it is geared to favor the upper caste and how it is geared to oppress and exploit and even further marginalize the marginalized communities, it is very disturbing and it makes you feel really, really guilty and to an extent where you don't feel like doing anything at all.
Yeah.
But when I was in that situation at one point, which was about 3 years ago when we were just beginning this journey, I met an activist called Xavier Dias, who has spent his entire life working with Adivasi, and he's an advocate for Adivasi and tribal communities. And he's the one who told me, he's like, it's not your fault you are born in privilege. Like, you did not decide which family to be born into. That's something that you cannot control at all. It's like biologically impossible. But it does matter what you do with it. It does matter how you use your privilege, where your energy goes, and whether you choose to live your life perpetrating the same things that have been going on till today, or you choose to put a stop to it somewhere, or maybe not a complete stop, but at least try to make the situation better in some way. And that has stayed with me. Like, that one thing really, it made me feel better and it made me do something. Like, you should not feel guilty. Guilt is totally a wasted emotion, but you should not feel guilty to such an extent that you just don't do anything. Like, it shouldn't immobilize you in that, like, harsh a way. So if we use that guilt and put it towards a positive action, channelize it in a place where we're actually being a good ally to indigenous communities and Adivasis and tribals in India, then it makes a difference, you know? Just us thinking to ourselves in our silos that, oh, I'm privileged, that doesn't change anything. So I think it's good. I think more people need to realize their privilege, just like I did, because it can turn into something really positive.
So, yeah, I mean, I think you said something really important there, Isha, where you mentioned that when you're first sort of coming to terms with the privilege that you hold in society, there is this tendency perhaps to just not know what to do with it, just not know what to do with the information. And for this sense of inertia to set in where you're like, okay, what do I do? Where do I begin? And oftentimes, you know, particularly when it comes to how social media is involved, it's a useful way to amplify people's voices. And then, you know, you see all of these ambiguous messages on social media, which is like, okay, you should take a day of rest and you should, you know, take self-care day or mental health care day, etc. So, I mean, speaking to you particularly, like, how do you as a person decide when to step in and speak up and when to disconnect? Especially because a lot of people use the fact that, you know, I have to look after my mental health to completely avoid speaking about issues altogether.
Okay, so this has been a huge learning, especially now when there is a pandemic and I am still working in this sector and we come across news which are really disturbing at times. And like, everything is intersectional. So it's not just about, because I'm privileged, certain things don't affect me. It's not like that. I have personal experiences which trigger me as well. For example, if I hear about a rape happening, now that is something I don't think I can handle in that moment of time, especially in this situation where everything is already fragile. But I think we have to find a way to understand that just reading the news, it's not helpful to anyone. The more news you consume, especially during COVID-19, I think all of us have realized that consuming news does nothing. Like, it is useless trying to keep up with the numbers of the people that have died. But if something like disturbs you even a little bit, maybe we should try to think in a more solution-oriented manner that, okay, this is a problem. Now, just consuming more content about the problem is not going to change it in any way. So, okay, this is a problem. What can I do to solve this? What skill sets do I have? What experience do I have in my field of work or in my experience in life that I can do something? I can utilize those skills. I can utilize the information and the knowledge that I have to be an ally to anybody who is suffering, anybody who is being targeted by a lot of different people. What can I do to change that? And ALM was an attempt to do that. Now, it is very easy to just sit, like I said, in a silo and keep criticizing the people who are doing this and say, okay, this is wrong. Okay, there is no representation of Adivasis and tribals in the media. What can we do to change that? That's how ALM was born. All the frustration and the everything, the negative emotion was channelized into something where it started making a difference that, okay, this is the problem. There is a gap here. Here is how we can solve it. That, I think, is really important. And a lot of people don't think that. A lot of people on social media are very geared to be reactive to everything, something even I am guilty of. I see something bad, I post it on my Insta stories, and I'm like, this is horrible, 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 horrible. But then I'm like, this is just aggravating people. What am I telling them? Okay, I'm disturbing people by sharing this with them. It's making them angry. It's making them upset. What solution am I providing to them? And yes, sometimes awareness helps. But wouldn't it be more helpful if we all thought of ways to change it? So whether it be a petition, whether it be a movement, whether it be a protest, just channelize it into an action. Because just thinking about it, just this intellectual bubble that we're in, it doesn't help. So yeah, we need to post about more Adivasi and tribal people and their issues and their rights. But we also need to be very careful about how we are talking about them. You spoke about intersectionality. I think involving and including indigenous people into any conversation is very important, because it's not like they are completely separate from whatever is happening in the world. Climate change related to indigenous people, gender rights related to indigenous people, everything, sustainability related to indigenous people. And not many people are involving them and including them in solutions, in conversations, in discussions about very important topics. So I think we need to step aside from this reactive behavior where we just, okay, this is horrible, this is horrible, this is horrible. But what are you doing to amplify Adivasi voices? Like, is your feed diversified? Are you following indigenous people on your Instagram or your Twitter, on your Facebook? How are you supporting people who are doing good work? Are you sharing stuff that they are doing? Are you donating to their efforts? What are you doing? Are you brainstorming solutions? Are you volunteering for the efforts? Like, what are you doing? I think that's the question we should be asking themselves. I don't believe in just being angry and sitting on that anger and hatching it. Do something with it. That's all that matters in the end.
So, yeah, and I'm actually really glad that you brought up the issue of sustainability, Isha, because the whole world is now talking about sustainability. They're talking about the importance of reducing one's waste, reusing. And so much of the conversation is centered on how we can change the way we consume. So even if it's not intended, you know, I'm just giving the benefit of the doubt here, but even if it's not intended, a lot of the messaging around sustainability seems to come across that you can shop your way or buy your way to a more sustainable lifestyle. So Ashish, this is my question more specifically to you. What do you think about this increase in conversation on sustainability, and just what are your thoughts?
Sustainability, people have to understand that, according to me, the sustainability is all about doing things on your own. I always include these points, like sustainability is like growing your own food, not being dependent on market. Like in Adivasi community, people are all self-independent. They don't go to market and purchase things. They believe in growing their own. Even in the festivals, if we see the things that are used in the festivals, they don't buy from the market. They make things, all things that are needed are homemade and are very eco-friendly. So in terms of that also, it shows that Adivasi people, the whole lifestyle of their community is sustainable. And if I pinpoint this market thing, that this market has started 60 to 70 years ago, and it is not just Adivasis were only sustainable people on this planet. The non-Adivasis were also sustainably living long before. So why all these changes have happened? Why all these changes are now? So I think all these things have started because of capitalism, because of more profit. According to me, the problems have arisen because of this ideology of capitalism and all.
Isha, would you like to add to that?
So as an urban person who is just dabbling into the field of sustainability, I think what you said first about people think they can buy their way into sustainability, that is just not true. That is completely counterintuitive to what we are actually intending to do. So you see a lot of these shops selling sustainable products, and that's great if you want to, if you're running out of stuff and you don't have anything at all. But something Ashish's father actually said in one of our Instagram lives, he said, you should learn from the Adivasis how to keep things around you, only those things that you need, like you really, really need. And instead of hoarding, just use what you need and that's it. And that concept is something a lot of people don't understand. They don't understand that the most sustainable thing you can have is the one you already have. Like you don't need to buy something new in order to be sustainable, unless there's a really good reason for it. But I think it's more about just being mindful about our consumption patterns and how much we are tricked into buying things which we just do not need at all. And that is something I have learned from Ashish. I've learned from his family and just from so many other indigenous people across the world. Is you take what you need and you leave the rest alone. It's not about overconsumption or about status or about, you know, like showing your worth through things. That is just, I've not seen that in many Adivasi communities. And I think all of us have a big lesson to learn from that, especially from the creating shops to promote sustainability sort of movements that are happening.
Do you think that, I mean, this is an impression that I get, so I'm just curious to know if you both have a similar impression. Do you think that the concept of sustainability as we know, or as we at least talk about at the moment, is superficial? Like it's just at the surface, because we're not talking about, and Ashish, you mentioned capitalism, you mentioned extractivism. Do you think that, you know, this conversation on sustainability just completely lacks its essence if the conversation does not include the context of how land, forests, and livelihoods have been continuously over the years forcefully being taken away from Adivasi communities?
Yeah, absolutely. The thing is, when we talk about Adivasis, about climate change and sustainability, on one side, you are talking about all these positive things, and on the other side, you are destroying their whole life, ruining their whole life by implementing dangerous laws of evicting Adivasis. So government on the other side is not just government. The people who are the organizations who talk on climate change and sustainability, what roles they are actually playing to save Adivasi communities. Are they? I think they are not. The majority of people who are related to activism, I think they are only concerned. The rest of the people are not concerned at all.
I agree with Ashish there, because a lot of these sustainability movements and anti-climate change movements do not include indigenous people in their conversations. Like Adivasis have literally saved planet for us. Whatever is left of it now, whatever good part is left of it, is basically where the indigenous communities live. They've saved the forest. They live in harmony with the forest. There is no capitalism there. There's no overconsumption there. There's no rapid industrialization of the smallest things there. This is all something that the urban lifestyle has brought upon through capitalism, obviously. And I don't think a lot of us realize this. Like the sustainable movements, as you clearly mentioned, are very superficial because they don't include these deeper conversations, these uncomfortable conversations, I'd like to say, because it's easier to buy a bamboo toothbrush than to address systemic oppression of indigenous communities who have been suffering because of the needs of the people living in the city, because they are not receiving everything that is being mined from their areas. It is us. It is coming to the cities, the coal, the electricity. It's all for cities. It's not for the villages that Adivasis and tribals live in. This is an uncomfortable conversation. And it's just easier to buy something off of Amazon than to speak about this. So, yeah.
And I know that Ashish mentioned this as well in the beginning of the conversation, but I'm really glad that you guys brought up the topic of coal in particular. And Ashish, if you could just talk a little bit about the draft EIA 2020 and the impact that it will have on Adivasi lives, just to sort of contextualize the issue before we talk a little bit more about coal in detail.
So there are many policies that protect Adivasi, and there are policies that protect the environment. So I would like to give you an example. In Jadugoda, when the uranium mining lease was completely over, there was a public hearing. And that public hearing is always conducted under the EIA and the EPA, EIA Environmental Impact Assessment, and that is another. So in public hearing, the Adivasis were not included at all, not at all. Some Adivasis were included, but who were employees, but other people like activists were completely ignored, because that was the time when we had that opportunity to discuss on the EIA, like what measures is the company going to take when it will pollute the nature, it will pollute the environment, like air, water, what measures it will take. So it all comes under EIA draft. And that important draft, and also I would like to mention that before all these, there is a one-year assessment report, like EAs in Jadugoda. What I had personally experienced was company is supposed to do a one-year assessment report, and it needs to show the local people that this particular project will benefit you, and if anything happens, then that they will take some measurement to control or balance the impact on air, water, environment, whatever. But that same law is diluted. And even in the presence of that law, that happened. So what do you imagine, that if the EIA will completely be diluted, then the scenario will be very worse. People will not even ask Adivasis what they think. They will not even bother to ask. And this is a completely targeted and a completely pre-planned strategy of the government to destroy Adivasi lives. Because Adivasis are the people who have the largest number of lands, and all the lands are with Adivasis. And underneath the land, what is there? The rich minerals. And the government is not concerned about Adivasis. Government and corporate people are all concerned about what's underneath the Adivasis. So definitely, draft EIA 2020, if it's successfully implemented, then all Adivasis, even I think where I live, I will be directly impacted by this.
Isha, would you like to add anything to that?
Yeah, like Ashish said, it's going to affect Adivasi and tribal communities very badly, because this basically takes away their voice, like he said, and that is not okay, and something that's very normalized by now over the last few years. But to go into the more legal aspect of this, there was a process where the tribal and Adivasi communities, or any community which was going to be affected by big scale projects like industries or mining or whatever, they had to have public hearings with the community to understand what they thought of it. Now, not only has this time been reduced, but they are planning to expedite the process using COVID-19 as an excuse. So that takes away the voice of the communities to say anything. And especially now, people can't protest. They can't mobilize. They can't come together. They can't show their dissent. So it's very dangerous to just allow companies to take over whatever land they put their eye on, where they want to make factories or mine, without thinking of the long-term impact of this. And somehow I feel like we are moving backwards, since most of the other countries, or I would say a few of the other countries, are moving towards a plan where they are acknowledging that climate change exists, and they are trying to save their forests, and they are trying to reduce their impact on the environment. And somehow I feel like India is saying this, but we're doing the exact opposite. So it's very disturbing to see. And no matter how many petitions and no matter how many signatures they got, I honestly am unsure of what this holds for not just Adivasis and tribals. If it affects them, it's going to affect us eventually. This is what people don't understand, I feel, that it's not affecting an isolated community. It's going to affect everyone. Because if the forests are gone, Adivasis will be displaced, obviously, but it's also going to rid us of whatever we need to survive. And that is just nature in general. So it's very important to for everyone to understand this problem. It's not related to just one particular community. It's going to have a ripple effect across the entire country.
Yeah, I think that's really important because what you mentioned specifically that although Adivasi communities are directly affected, it's not that the rest of our country or the rest of the planet, you know, on a very large scale, is removed from the outcomes of these policies or is not going to be affected by the outcomes of these policies. And I think sometimes there may be an overemphasis on talking about extractivism when it comes to or fracking and coal and shale gas, but also, you know, I want to take a minute to talk about environmental racism, where, you know, there are certain communities, and in India, that's probably most likely Adivasi communities, who are at the receiving end of environmental racism, where they live can often become a dumping ground for waste. And I wanted to ask you, Ashish, if you could possibly just talk about Jaherthan, which is now actually a dumping ground for nuclear waste.
So Jaithan is actually not the dumping ground for nuclear waste. So initially what happened in Jadugudha was with the ideology of what people think about Adivasis. So long before when the whole nuclear industry started, it was discovered around 1960s and the operation started in 1967. So in this process of uranium mining and the enrichment of the uranium ore to yellow cake, a huge amount of radioactive waste is generated. So to dump that waste, it's very expensive. So this is a theory of what I think. This is not a theory of mine. So long time ago, the scientists thought that if they dump the uranium waste in a distance of 50-60 kilometers from the Adivasi belt, it will be very expensive for them. So what they decided to dump the uranium waste next to the tribal resident, next to the tribal village. So they thought the Adivasis will never understand what this uranium mining is, and they will never understand about the hazard, about the negative impacts of it. So that is what happened. And imagine if this happened in the city of Mumbai or in Delhi, will the non-Adivasis allow it to happen in those places? It will never happen. All this happened because they considered, they assumed that Adivasis will never know. They will never know. And this is why it happened. And I always say, if the Indian government, this is not just about dumping uranium waste, it's also exploring or mining of any minerals. If suppose the Indian government finds mineral stoke underneath a parliament house, will the government start mining there? No, it will never. So why only they are targeting Adivasis? And we are all talking about sustainability. And this Jaherthan it's the perfect symbol of sustainability. So this Jaherthan is the sacred place of Adivasis where they worship. And like I always say that if there is a protection of trees, so Jaherthan is one of the safest place on the planet where trees are protected. Because in my Adivasi community also, we are strictly prohibited to cut trees in Jaherthan, not even a tiny branch. We cannot cut. If anybody dare to do that, then they will be punished. And our Jaherthan is also not respected by the government. And what they have done right now is Jaherthan is in one particular place, but they have started dumping waste around it. So right now there are 3 tailing ponds in Jadugoda. First, second, and third. And this Jaherthan is between them. And the seepage water, the radioactive lethal waste And the seepage water from the tailing pond is a drowning this Jair Khan. So they don't respect Adivasi. They don't respect their sacred place also. It's very unacceptable for my community here.
For those of you who want to read more about this and maybe watch a video about this, you should head over to Ashish's Youth Ki Awaaz account. He has a full article about this and with photos and everything. And there's a video also, which will help you understand what the situation is like and how important this site is for the Adivasis in Jadugoda. And like he said, it's unacceptable. So yeah, just find Ashish on Youth Ki Awaaz and read his work. That's where you'll get a lot of information.
Yeah, and I think that's a very key element of the whole conversation on environmental racism, right? Is we talk about it and it's like Isha, you mentioned earlier, it's just very much in this elitist niche conversation circles that concepts totally. Like these are being discussed. And when you actually understand and you actually listen and you speak to someone who is directly affected by it, only then do you actually get an understanding of what the issue is and the extent to which it is lingering or it is persistent or the extent of harm it causes.
Absolutely. If I didn't know Ashish, I would probably not know about this because nobody speaks about it. And even if they do speak about it, mainstream media does not cover it or does not dare to cover it. So where are people supposed to get this information from? Unless they actually look for it, like specifically look for it, they're not going to find it. It's not in textbooks. It's not anywhere where people can find. It's not on any Scoop Whoops or BuzzFeeds or anywhere where most people have their attention nowadays. So very difficult to get people to understand these issues and just give a damn about them.
Adivasis have always been dependent on forest. So what they do is, if they don't get food from the market, they don't buy vegetables. If there is no vegetable available in the market, what they do is they go to the forest. In my place, they go to the forest during this pandemic also, and there were very less vegetables being sold in the market. All they were doing is they used to go to the forest. They used to bring leafy vegetables, wild fruits, and that is how they were surviving. And in complete remote area, complete rural area, that yeah. there is no option of market. Yeah. The whole Adivasi community is fully dependent on forest. And during this pandemic, and also last year in 2019, when the Supreme Court announced the eviction of 8 million people. So those people, if they will be completely evacuated from their lands, they will die. They always quote in Adivasi that Adivasis cannot live without their lands and without forest. That is what they all have with them. That is their asset.
Yeah, I mean, what Ashish is saying, I just remembered from what he was saying about the Aare forest, because there are thousands of Adivasis living inside the Aare forest in Mumbai. Mm-hmm. And I remember when I was being told about the issue, this was, I think, a couple of years ago, when there are a lot of people interested in that land because apparently it's prime real estate and people want to build stuff there, including now the metro yard, which was the most recent thing, but a lot of people have their eye on that land. So there was a plan which was being made to displace the Adivasis from the Aare forest into apartments. And the Adivasis there are farming. They have farms. Like, that's where they get their food from. They have chicken and they have the huge trees. It's a forest. So basically everything that they consume comes from the forest itself, and they take exactly as much they need, and the rest is all thriving over there. And I remember feeling so weird that people thought this was a good idea to take tribals out of their forest, because it's their land, and put them in apartment, like 1 BHK apartments. What do they expect to happen there? Where is the cattle going to go? Like, where is their food going to come from? What do you expect to happen in a situation like that? it's one of the most bizarre things. That's why it stuck with me, because I think that's the situation that's happening everywhere. At least there was discussion of rehabilitation in this context. In most places, rehabilitation, nobody knows where the tribe goes after they have been displaced from their forest. Like I said, it's just bizarre. It just surprises me every day what we come up with as solutions. There has to be, Archana Soren says this a lot, that we have to include Adivasis in conversations when it comes to tackling anything. She focuses on climate change, but anything. You want to build something that you feel is important for the development of this country, speak to people, like find alternatives. Come up with a solution that works for all communities. Don't exploit and extract and take away the source of security and food and just living in general. It's just an unacceptable thing to do. I still can't understand how people manage to do it, but I guess profit trumps everything. So,
yeah, and I think that's a prime example of how in India and also like I think all over the world, right, like displacing indigenous communities has been the way in which colonizers have actually acquired land, right? And in a way, you could also argue that this model of development that we are constantly pursuing in India, where it's like all the forests have to go and all the land has to be grabbed, is also a form of colonialism in that way, where we are actually actively working to displace and like separate indigenous communities from their land and livelihoods. And then we turn around and say that if they work hard, then they can get whatever they want, they can be better off financially, etc., without realizing how they themselves have created a system in which indigenous communities can't thrive.
So Sanchi, I was telling that Adivasis have been always looked as an obstacle for the development. So if we look at all the development countries, Adivasis have been mistreated and many Adivasis have been killed for the sake of development. Take an example of America. Even there are Adivasis in Japan also, but very less people know about that. They are called Ainu. All these development countries have really mistreated Adivasis. And also, I would like to add this, and not all people like, and it's very uncomfortable for many of the people, like Adivasis are like Adivasi. Adivasi means jo adikal se base hue log hai. The native, the indigenous, the real owners of the country, and all other people, they came afterwards. So if the people who came afterwards are trying to destroy Adivasis, so even there have been, I saw a movie, everybody knows about that, the Avatar of James Cameron.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is the perfect example what's happening with the Adivasis.
Yeah, I was just saying that why do we feel like, especially like you said, the elitist urban mentality, why is it that we want to force everybody to live like us in this capitalist society when indigenous people have their thing going on, when where they are self-sufficient and they have their land and they are perfectly fine with it? Why are we trying to impose our way of finding a job and working these hours and contributing to multi-million dollar companies? Why is it that just because we live like that, we want everybody to live like that as well? It just does not make sense. If they have a self-sufficient, sustainable system where they are happy in the village and or in the forest and they are helping to contribute, save that piece of forest, then I don't think we should have the entitlement and audacity to try and mainstream in quotes. I hear this word a lot, like, when are we going to develop Adivasi areas and mainstream and civilize Adivasis? And I feel like we have the audacity to think that way, but it's not our place to do so. Nobody's coming and telling us how we should live our lives. Just because we want to buy into this capitalist mindset and consumerist mindset, that's our thing, that's just what we want to do. But we are nobody to tell people how they should live their lives. So I think this is all privilege. It's just privilege talking that like you said, it's a, I don't know about colonialism, that's exactly what the British did with India, but I feel like we have learned a lot about how to do that ourselves. And this takes a lot of introspection to realize and to unlearn these things because they are so embedded into our everyday lives. Students I've spoken to have used the word mainstream and civilized, and I'm like, who told you that they are uncivilized? Like, where is this vocabulary coming from? It either comes from the news or it comes from the textbooks. That's, or the internet, basically. So very, very important journey to take.
And Ashish, you know, just to like sort of take on after what Isha said just there, which actually also is my final question for you, you know, what should be included in the conversations on sustainability? You know, we're talking about it now in the pandemic, we're talking about it and we're hoping that once the pandemic stabilizes or is over, you know, on the other side of coronavirus, there is a better, more just, sustainable world. But in order for that image to be true, what do we have to do differently today that perhaps we weren't doing before coronavirus hit us?
The first thing is the people all around the world should learn from Adivasis how they celebrate festivals eco-friendly. So in Adivasi, there is no concept of playing music with big sound systems and woofers. There is no concept of burning firecrackers. There is no concept of making idols and submerging in the rivers and ponds or in ocean. So that thing can be, the commercialization of festivals should completely be banned and stopped. And I think that should be the first change that should be brought in each community.
And in terms of how we can contribute to or help with movements such as the Adivasi Lives Matter movement, you know, can you talk a bit more about what is needed over there? Especially if you're a non-Adivasi.
I will only say about what non-Adivasis can do, which is a lot, by the way. People are like, oh my God, what can I do about this? Like, it's such a far-fetched thing, apparently, but it's really not. Everyone who's on social media right now, I guess the first thing we can do is just follow more Adivasi and tribal creators and where the actual news is coming from. That would be really, really helpful to all of us. The second thing is just, it's a journey to sort of acknowledge our own privilege and to see the language we're using and how we are talking about Adivasis and tribals and how we, just the things we say in everyday life, which are completely wrong and sort of lead to a much bigger problem because people talk. And when one person starts talking that way, it's sort of, it's like a herd mentality and everybody sort of believes it. So we, as I mentioned before also, we have to be inclusive. We have to include them in conversations that are important, not just for them, but for everybody, because it's never, nothing ever affects just one community on this planet. It's going to affect everyone. And when it comes to sustainability, we touched upon this a little bit before, but especially veganism, that is somehow people are thinking that this is something that needs to be done. Everybody should sort of adapt the concept of veganism. And otherwise, we're all horrible human beings who have no compassion for the animals. I think that in itself is a very elitist, privileged concept, which comes sometimes from religion, sometimes from the ideas of morality, of what is right and wrong. And just this pure thing, you know, like we should have pure food and we should only eat plants. And that's a very, very Indian thing, especially now we're seeing a rise in that sort of a mentality. And as a person who attended one vegan march and never went back, I realized that this is not a movement that includes indigenous people at all, because they are calling people who eat animals murderers. They are saying that they are incompassionate and they just don't care about animals at all. And I think people just need to educate themselves, because it's not the Adivasis that are harming the animals. The concept of veganism is great. Like, in an ideal world, it is great. But I think people should understand that the animal slaughter that they are protesting against is a product of industrialization and capitalism. It's not the Adivasis and tribals who are practicing it. They are not creating huge factories. to slaughter and torture animals and put hormones and chemicals in them in order to increase their productivity or the quality of the meat or anything. None of this is happening in Adivasi communities. It's happening because the demand for it is very large in cities, and that's why this is being done. And this is just one example of how people start shaming indigenous people for how they have been living forever. And I don't know where people get this concept that indigenous people are anti-nature or anti-animals. It's quite the opposite, actually. They are not trying to create a business out of it as such. Most of them are not. And their relationship with animals is very different from what we go to the store and buy and eat. It's not like that. They know the animals. They worship the animals. I know some indigenous communities who thank the animals for the protein and the food that they are about to provide them. That concept we don't have at all. We are just, it's all about profit. It's all about mass consumerism. And we need to step out of that mindset and think about the planet as a whole, which is not just urban cities, but it's also many, 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 many forests with many, many indigenous people. And unless we even like think from that perspective, I don't think sustainability or anything is even possible. You are taking out the people who are literally following the sustainable way of life when almost nobody else is. You're removing them from the conversation. That does not make any sense. They have to be included. You have to, I would say, you just follow the footsteps of Adivasis and tribals. Like Ashish very correctly said, just learn, just observe and learn, because they hold the keys to climate change, to sustainability, to helping the planet heal, to everything. And only if we step out of that mindset that we know everything and, you know, we are educated and privileged and we have all the answers, we don't know anything, nothing. If we were to be put in forests, we wouldn't survive, because there is no way we have the skills to survive in that sort of an environment. Whereas if you see Ashish's videos, I feel like I have no skills compared to the skills that he has, because those are real world skills for survival. And he has the knowledge of nature and environment, which I don't think I will have, no matter how many books I read or how many videos I watch. It's practical experience and it's passed down from generation to generation. So like he said, just follow their footsteps and learn. Get out of the I know everything mindset and just learn.
Yeah, and I think just to sort of, you know, just leave this with our listeners perhaps, is that veganism does not equal cruelty-free. So it's great that plant-based alternatives and that conversation is happening. I think it's very important. And I think if you can make a choice and you are in a privileged position to make a choice, you should choose to eat local. You should, of course, choose to eat more plants. But I think the most important thing is realizing that if you value the life of animals, or, you know, over and above the people or animals or plants, over and above the people who actually produced, who actually grew, who actually put in their labor and entire supply chain, is not just the plant just grew and it landed on your plate, right? It's like some people have actually worked and grown that plant for you to eat it. So you have to realize that there is a huge supply chain there. And most likely, because as it is in the current systems we live in, it is mismanaged. So you have to understand that even eating vegan is not devoid of issues of equity or justice, or who is making your food and how is it being made and whether or not they have been paid, etc. You know, so it's important to remember that this is also not one sort of one solution that can solve climate change or whatever.
Yeah, of course not. I don't think people realize the human capital and the human cost that goes behind even vegetarian food. Everyone wants to talk about veganism, but nobody wants to talk about the plight of the farmers in India and how much they are just suffering because of the system and the lack of support from the government. It's, like I said, uncomfortable conversations. I feel like everyone's choosing a very convenient route when it comes to advocating for something. And I think we are better than that. I think we can do much better, go much deeper into any topic or anything that we feel really strongly about. I think we need to go to the roots, because nothing is as it seems. There are a lot of systems in play which come from very, very long ago. And unless we address those, very difficult to change things on the surface.
Thank you so much. Ashish, would you like to add anything to what Isha and I have said?
I will not add to that, but I will would like to give a message to all the listeners who will be listening to this podcast. The whole world is now talking about Adivasi ideology, and this is the only way to save all of us from climate crisis. And that will be only possible if we look at the sustainability, like growing your own food, less dependent of money, or completely quit using money. That is a solution, I think, for many of us.
Yeah, and thank you so much for that. I think we'll end the episode over there. I just want to say thank you so much, Ashish, for being here, for bringing your knowledge, and for talking about all of these various issues. Thank you, Isha, as well. It's been such a great conversation. I've learned a lot, and I'm really, really happy that you could find the time for this once again.
Thank you for having us.
I would like to welcome and request all the listeners to follow our work on the social media platforms and read as much stories you get on the internet, on the Adivasi Rights Matter platform. We have a microsite with youthkiawas.com/Adivasi Lives Matter, and you will find lots of stories created by Adivasi content creators. And I would also request, please share those stories, become an ally for Adivasis, and amplify our Adivasi voices.
Yes.
Thank you, and Johar.
Yes, this is amazing. So this is why the podcast is called Amplify Everyone, so that you can actually get on board with the work that people are doing, and in this case, particularly Ashish and Isha are doing with Adivasi Lives Matter movement. And I will obviously add the details to your microsite and your social media in the episode description as well when the episode is out, so that people can navigate to it directly. And thank you so much for being here once again.
Thank you, Sachi.
Thank you. This was fun.
Of this week's episode. Thank you so much for tuning in. You can find all the relevant links and handles to know more about our guest this week in the episode description. If you have any feedback, suggestions, requests, or simply just want to get in touch with us, then please do head over to our podcast website. We are available to flag and say hi to via Facebook, Instagram, or email.